Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to have you all here, and thank you for the introduction. I was appointed officially as the next artistic director for the 21st Biennale of Sydney in July, and then I had been already interested in looking at the archive of the Biennale, because I had to question myself after having all these Biennales and triennials in Asia and the Pacific now, and I just wanted to question why Sydney now? Do we still need one more? And but it's one of the oldest, and what is the meaning of Sydney Biennale? All these fundamental question that occurred. And then I knew that archive had been handed over to Art Gallery New South Wales, and then I started to look at it. It's so interesting. It's such an interesting resources that it's, for me, it's like a treasure box. And then also I thought there are so many people involved in the Biennale in the last 45 years, and so many of my colleagues and art professionals in the museum had something to do with Biennale in the past. Maybe started as an assistant curator or something to do with this the entire history. So I started to propose the idea of interviewing some of the important figure in the history. And then another thought occurred, maybe I can do it in the public. So this series of, we just named the Biennale Archive Stories, is I have very little knowledge of the history of Biennale. So I'm starting to invite different important figures to tell us the stories and some important story that we should sort of hand over to next generations. And so I'm delighted to begin this story series today, having Paula Latos-Valier, who had been part of the very important Biennale history, studied as assistant director 1981 to 88, executive officer 89, general manager 97 to 2004, and managing director 2004 to 2007. And then we have Djon Mundine, who had been also a very important part of the development of the Biennale, particularly in 1988 Biennale, and as a part of the concept curator for the Aboriginal Memorial, which he will talk about, tell us more about. Then we have Mr. Mike Parr, who had been participating in the Biennale 7 times, and he has the highest record of the number of participation in the Biennale.
And ran a mile in 3 minutes 56 seconds.
And together with Joseph Boyce, he also participated in 7 times, but actually he never came. So he has the highest record of appearance. And so I'm so honored to have 3 of us, and just to please welcome these 3 distinguished speakers. And since our talk is only 1 hour, instead of asking them to make a presentation, I just wanted to flip through these very interesting slides from the past, then they can jump in and talk about important stories. So this is the design of the poster and also cover of the catalogue of 1973 Biennale of Sydney, which opened at the Sydney Opera House. And so that was a commemoration of the opening of the Opera House. And this is how John Coburn is looking at the poster production. And then this is the governor and then also Franco Belgiorno Nettis visiting first Biennale of Sydney at the Opera House. And this one, you can look at the lady with the kimono, who is Minami Tada, who was the Japanese women artist, and who tried to leave the sculpture. Maybe, Paula, already you can tell us a little bit of a story.
Well, it's interesting because I wasn't here in 73, but I read the 73 file, and it's full of letters from Franco back and forth with Minami. And he was desperately trying to keep that sculpture here. And he wrote to everyone. He wrote to corporations. He wrote to government. He wrote to Japanese companies. He wrote to individual collectors. He was actually trying to cobble together a sum of money that would allow the sculpture to stay here. very persuasive letters. He was passionate about it, but in the end, they couldn't do it.
I just love the story that when they probably started the Biennale, they never thought about what to do after Biennale is over. And they brought huge sculpture from Japan. Maybe they thought they could have the sculpture. And then we can go to 76 Biennale, which was the first participation of the art gallery of New South Wales. And the artistic director was Thomas McLaw. Then, again, this was very important because I was appointed as the first Asian artistic director. But in terms of the Asian artists, there had been quite a lot of Asian artists participated, particularly in the 76 version. They already had an idea of Asia-Pacific triangle. So there are a lot of Japanese artists, probably like 20 Japanese artists participated, and together with the artists from West Coast, America. And a lot of media art or technology art was thresholding around that time. And, this is the image from Fujiko Nakaya, another Japanese important artist who had participated in Biennale 2012. Yeah. And but she was very important figure to run the video art gallery called the Scan in Tokyo back then. Right. And when Bill Viola was staying in Japan in 80 to 81, she was an important supporter for his practice. Yeah. So that we can see this thread of the connections already.
Mami, there was a bit of necessity in the mother of invention in this, because Tom McCulloch, the artistic director, had so little money. And if you read the archive, you'll see his letters talking about, what can I do with this paltry sum of money in terms of research travel? And what he ended up finding is that he could make his way around the Pacific, and that was sort of it. He could go up one coast and down the other and then come back. And so that gave him the idea that he would do something that went up through Japan and came down the U.S. coast and dealt with California and Japan. So in a sense, yep, it was due to his budget,
yes,
in part.
I wonder if we can remember other things. I mean, I can remember standing outside the Art Gallery of New South Wales and protesting with a lot of Sydney artists, including Terry Smith. And we were protesting because Malcolm Fraser was opening that Biennale. And it was a year in the aftermath of Gough's dismissal. So the Sydney Biennale, I mean, has often been controversial for other reasons. It's kind of dynamic, and it's major in Sydney for that reason. And it continues to be controversial. So I'm just going to introduce that at this point. As
great,
a
great. And then 79, after looking at the Asia and the Pacific, 79 was more towards the European dialogue. So the focus shifted to relationship between Australia and Europe. Then a lot of performance art at the time, and this is the marks the first participation of Mike.
In this Biennale?
Yeah,
yes.
This one.
Ooh.
From 79. But maybe you can also talk about your view, why you were invited a number of times, but almost like regularly, particularly in 70s and 80s.
I was very useful in 1979. I was living in Vienna at the time. And I'd gone to Europe in 1977 to participate in the Paris Biennale des Jeunes.
Mm.
Tommaso Trini did the first performance Biennale in Paris then. And all these artists, Marina Abramovich and Ule and Joan Jonas and Laurie Anderson and Tina Gerard and Petter Stembra and Jan Milchok from Prague, all these artists came to Paris and we all did performances. And then afterwards we were invited to Vienna for a performance festival and we all went there. And it was then that I saw Nick Waterloo. He contacted me and he came to Vienna and we were together and he sat with all these people, and I knew a lot of artists in East Europe, so I was able to help with this Biennale.
Mm. But there was quite a big presence of East European artists.
There was, and it's an interesting story. I went to Budapest to the Bille Balak studio. I was invited there by a guy called Dr. Laszlo Becker in 1978. And I went there and showed my films, and when I left Hungary a week later, I was arrested. And I was sent back to Budapest. My passport was confiscated, and I had to go and see the internal police every day for a
Why were
a while.
You arrested?
What it did was you completely do? Ambiguous. They didn't like it. It was something to do with this film, and it was something to do with the artist that I was meeting.
Mm.
And when Nick put the Biennale together, Dr. Laszlo Becker was made the commissioner for the Hungarian artists, but he was refused to come to Australia because he was in contact with elements that were hostile to the Hungarian government. This was me. Becker never came to Australia, and I had a lot of documentation of these artists, East European artists, and it's in the Biennale archive, and we put it in the Biennale.
Great.
To represent these people. Great. So there were a lot of East European artists.
In 79.
These are all interesting stories. Yes, this is the subconscious, yes, the unconscious of the Biennale.
And then also 79 was important marking point to have a first Aboriginal artist in the Biennale. And, these are some of the articles. But maybe, John, you could tell us the stories and how it changed the position of Aboriginal art. And
yeah. Well, it was really weird because I actually went to Remangining, to this place where the artists come from. I actually, in January of that year, I actually went there to live. So the Biennale was happening here, and these men travelled with the man on the on your left, Peter. I'll think of his name in a minute. Yates. Thank you. You can read that. I can't, but Peter Yates, and they came here. They all came here. I remember they all were down here, and they came back with all these stories, and I was telling them. Telling Mike and so on before about how they saw all this art that they didn't understand, like about these white people, they're all really weird. All these performances by Marina Abramovich and Ule and people, and this very famous piece of Ule having this erection and then losing his erection and on a loop, and it sort of would go up and come down and come up. And that really amused everyone in Remangining. Kind of thing, yeah, well, that's art. That's white people's art. It was very important at the time because I think we had the 67 referendum that sort of introduced broad Aboriginal people into the national consciousness.
Mm.
And then we have the Whitlam government, the whole of that short period. It seems such a short period now that they existed. And we have a thing called the Aboriginal Arts Board set up and a number of other agencies, and they invited these people to come. They lived in a place, I lived on an island, and they lived on the mainland in the middle of a swamp, and that's where they made the film, The Ten Canoes. So they were off on this other, the wildest, most remote place. So it's interesting to choose them. And they were painters. So it's interesting because this is such a performance-based conceptual art sort of biennale in reality, but they were painters. Yeah. So, you've got to start somewhere. And I thought it was a very big step, and I was saying before how it was bringing Aboriginal people into the society. And maybe I said before that it's bringing them into the symbolic order. So we have a Biennale, which is a very establishment thing, and it's the the pinnacle of white Western art or white Australian art. And then, so we bring Aboriginal people into that fold, and that's a very big recognition, a very big movement.
Yes. Mm. Yeah, maybe, Mike, also you can talk about what you did in 79 within this context of bringing all these East European performance artists, also having Aboriginal appearance, that's a first appearance. And this is from your performance in 79. We have three images.
Yes, I did this piece. It was a large black minimal box with little holes in it.
So this is the inside of the black
box. Yeah, and I did six performances with members of my family and chooks and things. And I can remember I traumatised the people down here in the art gallery when I came with all these chooks. They took them years to get over the experience. But when I was installing the box, it was very interesting. I met René Bloch because... he was also here to install a Joseph Beuys piece. So it was one of, what was the title of that piece, where Beuys was sweeping the streets of Berlin, you know, and the rubbish was collected. So René arrived with all this rubbish that had been swept up on Unter den Linden or something and brought it to Sydney. And there was this international incident, and that's how I met René Bloch, because, what was his name? Bill Cito was working on my installation, helping me build my installation. We were working at top speed, you know, building, crazy building, and there was a lot of rubbish from our thing. And at the end of the day, Bill got a big broom and saw this. And in the morning, René came in and said, my God, Boyce's rubbish is all mixed up with Mike Parr's rubbish. And it was quite hilarious, really, because then it was sort of René went through all the rubbish and sort of sorted it out. And we became very friendly after that. Yeah, it was a bonding experience.
He will appear later too. And so we go to 82, maybe... That's one of the first Biennale that Paula participated, or part of it.
Look, it was a very interesting show. Bill Wright had been living overseas for many years, I think about 17 years, in the States and also in Britain. And he came back with very much a world perspective. And he decided that he would do a show that was very encyclopedic. And it was a show, you know, that had a performance section distinctly, and a lot of that was done at the Cell Block Theatre at National Art School. We had many venues for the 82 Biennale. He had a sound section that also involved ABC. We had a video section, which was at UTS, and that was in the days where you had, you know, these big clunky monitors and, you know, people would sit in front of the monitors and look at the latest videos, which were from all over the world. And then we had, classically, the exhibition itself with the main part of it being here. We had an incredible incident in 82. It was the first visit that we had from the Vice Squad. And that was because of Stupid as a Painter, the Juan de Vila painting, which was at Ross's gallery. And that was one of the venues for the Biennale. Ross was opening a new gallery, and it was great. We wanted a dispersed show, so we had the exhibition also there. And I remember picking up the phone, and Ross was on the other end of the phone. His voice was very calm, and given the circumstances. And she said, Paula, they're carrying out the painting. And I said, you know, what do you mean? And she said, well, you know, the police are here and they're seizing the Wanda Villa and they're actually carrying it out. And as she was saying this, she was also telling them to be very careful not to damage it. So, you know, it was like being sort of remotely there, virtually there. And so it was confiscated and all of that unfolded and it made the news headlines. It was on the front page of the news. We didn't know what was going to happen to it. Nobody had ever encountered this kind of situation, you know. So... But it also made morning television. And I happened to turn the television on one morning to get the weather, which you did back then. And I saw our catalog. And I had this moment where I couldn't put these two things together. I was looking at the television for the morning program, and our catalog was on the television. I couldn't work it on. And it was Fred Nile. And he was he was putting the catalog up and saying, we will be at the offices of the Biennale this morning when they open, and we will be confiscating this publication because it features, happened to be on page 48, the Juan de Villa painting in it. And there's an image of it. Now, the Vice Squad have already taken it, so we're going to take the catalogs. Well, my God, I called everyone I knew. I said, you've got to get to the Biennale office, bring bags and suitcases. And we dispersed the catalogs. We had people actually taking them away. And I'd just keep them and hide them until we let you know. And then eventually nothing came of it. Nobody came to the office to confiscate the catalogs. So we got them all back again. And they sold out in no time.
Fantastic. Yeah, and then also we had a major Aboriginal painting installation up here. John, maybe you can tell us.
Well, this, I was going to say before that thing with Juan de Villa. I mean, one of the good things in a way of having Aboriginal people being involved in this was it made people like Juan de Villa, Marina Abramovich, people like that, more aware of what Aboriginal people were doing themselves, etc., and how they could actually converse with an Aboriginal artist in that sense. So, and he's Juan de Villa's, of course, featured Aboriginal signifiers or references in his paintings as part of the story of Australia, so to speak. This group is so funny because it's actually incredibly powerful. These people went to Paris after this event for another major international exhibition, where they went back in time almost, because you had sort of Levi Strauss talking about them as they were trying to give their to tell the world about what they how they lived, how they created art. And you had this anthropologist saying, well, that what they are saying is blah, 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 and you notice how they sit and you notice how they hold the brush and you know, and so on. So that it was a stepping back in time. But this group, Morris Luther and these other people, actually made this work as a protest against the general painting movement in the desert. Mm. They said, we are not like those people in Papunya, Yuendamu, we don't make our art for commercial purposes. We make this for religious purposes, and we make it for these unique events, etc. And that's really what this statement was about. Whereas everyone else is going, isn't this fantastic? We're seeing all this stuff. It was actually the protest about the other Aboriginal people in the desert. Mm. However, these people at Hooker Creek actually then took to painting on canvas as well, very quickly, and that's another sort of schism, sort of thread in the painting movement of the Western Desert. But they, it was very powerful at the time. I thought Bill Wright to bring this off. It was very really important to bring this off. So you see these painters from Arnhem Land, you see these people, and then in the next Biennale you actually have people from the southeast in the Biennale as well. Sorry, go on.
Yeah. Do you remember this painting? You also participated in 82,
yes.
Mike.
Oh, yes, I remember. Yes, yes. No. There was a lot of painting in that Biennale.
There was. Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah, Bill was very into painting.
Of sort of neo-expressionism.
Yeah, Susan Rothenberg.
The new spirit in painting, it was called, in Europe. And so, Baselitz and what was his name? Terry, what was the other painter?
Kiefer.
Kiefer.
Anselm Kiefer?
No, not Kiefer. Who?
Gusten. Yeah.
Who?
Gusten.
Philip Gusten.
Gusten.
No. I was thinking of the German. He's dead now, very political. political painter. But anyway, he did a major painting and left it here in Australia.
But that was not 80...
Immendorf.
That was Immendorf. That was Jörg Immendorf.
Yeah.
I thought that was 84.
Yeah,
was that 84?
Yeah, I thought it was 84.
So what happened to that painting, by the way? I'm jumping ahead.
It went to the MCA. What happened is, and that's an amazing story, and I have the most wonderful slides of Jörg Immendorf. On the morning we had to move his painting, we had a terrible storm that weekend, and on Monday morning we were moving the painting. And this is really dangerous for a 7-meter painting that is still wet to move it out into the wind.
Mm.
It takes off like a sail. You know, you can't control it. So we got the largest truck we could get, but it still wasn't big enough for the painting, and the painting stuck out the back. But what was so important for us is that we worked hand in glove with the Art Gallery of New South Wales. And that meant that its conservation department came to the rescue, gave us their expertise, and this happened throughout the history of the Biennale, that we relied on the support and professionalism of the Art Gallery of New South Wales as our major partner until the MCA came on board in the 90s. So we went into the room that at East Sydney Tech, where the stretcher had been delivered and then was built inside the room with nobody looking at the height of the stretcher vis-a-vis the height of the door. And what happened is this enormous painting grew inside this room and then couldn't be gotten out of the room. So being wet, the conservators came, worked out that they could unstretch it, keep the surface apart, carry it out as a sling in sling form with people on both sides carrying painting out, and slip it into the back of the truck where it was suspended from the roof of the truck and would swing as it went through Sydney. The whole back of the truck was open to the wind and the weather. It was frightening.
I cannot imagine painting being carried like that.
It was frightening. And then it was unhooked and brought in, laid down face up, obviously, and re-stretched underneath. So it was an amazing feat. And then the painting got purchased by the MCA and it went into their collection.
I'm sort of interested in these sort of, there's this sort of underbelly to the Biennale that I find very interesting. You know, there's the, when did, you may remember, Paula, the Joseph Boyce, it's the tree, the fig tree.
Yeah, we're going to show the images.
It's interesting,
later.
Isn't it? Because there's all these works that get left behind
and then they become orphans,
you know. Yeah. And the stone, there's lots of...
Maybe, Paula, you want to...
No, you go ahead.
Do you want to tell a story about...
Yeah. I don't actually know the stories.
It's interesting, though, isn't it? Because that stone, you know, it's one of the reasons why I did this piece, America.
That's right.
Where I kind of slept and walked around this tree, you know, for three days because I was trying to get it restored. But the stone got delivered to the custodians of the domain, you know, Parks and Gardens, and became anonymous. But I think René came back and rescued that stone. It went back to Germany. It should come... We should somehow or other rehabilitate this work, you know, because this is... Yeah. Has the tree gone
now? No.
Oh, that's... I haven't been down for a while, so we've bulldozed the tree now, have we? Oh, okay. Things move rapidly. Yeah. So this is really interesting. So this is an aspect of the Biennale that's very important.
I thought the tree is still here, yeah.
And, you know, we open up new ground and then it gets covered up again. So it's very interesting. So there is a dialectic going on, you know, a dialectic of sort of one step forward and, you know, three or four, I suppose, back. So it's really interesting because it also speaks to the dynamism of the Biennale.
Yes.
And this is the thing that I think is really important, you know, because Mami is really asking now fundamental questions about its relevance for the future. Its relevance for the future is this kind of controversy and
So, energy. Energy. When you think of
the otherwise, if you don't do that, it's just a formality.
It's just a waste of time. Yeah, really. Just coming automatically every 2 years.
Yeah.
But I wanted to note that the first four times until 1982, the fourth version, the Biennale only happened every 3 years. So there was an article in the archive saying probably the Biennale of Sydney, the only Biennale which happens every 3 years. And 73, 76, 79, and 82. So you can really see how hard it was to start raising up this baby Biennale, and finding resources and venues. And I still think 2 years comes very quickly, and you realize once you start working on it. So I could really see the reason why it took 3 years, naturally.
Well, back then, you know, everything was done by airmail.
I know, or I can cable. See all these letters.
You know, 2 weeks, yes. 2 weeks for a letter, you know.
So yeah, without email.
It'd be hard to do it in 2 years.
And just wanted to comment on this, the Boyce tree. And Boyce had requested advice on an Australian tree for the Sydney context to replace the European oak instead of his 7,000 oak project. And the Royal Botanic Garden Trust suggested the Marton Bay fig tree. Then, but the Royal Botanical Garden Trust did not approve for the basalt stone to remain in a place indefinitely. So in 1988, the stone was removed by the Botanical Garden Trust staff. And then gallery asked for the stone to be returned and advocated, as it did in 1984, for the work to be permitted permanent display on the original site. But stone was returned to the gallery, but site approval was denied. So stone was taken, and then I think a tree is still growing. Do you think it's still
gone? No, it's still there.
Still there.
It's still there.
Yeah.
Don't worry, Baird will get rid of that tree.
We can go check. We'll all go after and check.
A bit of Roundup will fix that, Gita, though.
Yeah, the tree is still there. I think it's a really beautiful story.
It's really interesting, isn't
it? Yeah, yeah. And then we can go to 86. Then, this is the time when they started to use Pier 2 and 3.
Yeah, that was the first Biennale that we used the pier. And I think it was such a transformative thing to do for the Biennale, to take basically a forgotten, totally derelict, polluted, leaking venue and clean it up. And that was really, it was Gita and Chris who did the spade work there. And, you know, if it wasn't for them, we would not have had that venue. And it was very, very difficult.
Anne Flanagan.
And it was very, very difficult, and it was awful work. But they transformed this into one of the most startling exhibition venues.
Looks amazing.
And it was an amazing experience for people because at this time, you know, the whole Walsh Bay, Hickson Road, Miller's Point area was virtually derelict. Nobody went there. It was deserted. It was a kind of unknown part of the city in the middle of the city, which is so incongruous. And yet, once this opened, I mean, the scales fell off people's eyes, and they thought, my God, the majesty of these sort of industrial waterfront venues, incredible. It was really a kind of industrial cathedral space. And Yedalova's piece, which I think was the last piece, or this piece, I can't quite see. Yeah, this is the Yedalova's piece, was massive. And, you know, you couldn't have put it anywhere else in Sydney. It was transformative for the public and inspirational for the artists.
I think it's very important to have this kind of non-institution space for the Biennale. And then now we have a Cockatoo Island, but such kind of extraordinarily spatial experience with the giant installation is some of the particular nature of the Biennale, what we think is Biennale. And while a lot of Biennale in Asia is just becoming a large exhibition in the museum. So it's interesting to see how the Sydney Biennale had been having a very particular special site for the Biennale.
Well, we used the pier again in 86, And
yes,
then,
we did, yes.
Sorry, in 86 first and yes. then 88. And then it kind of went into a hiatus. We used it again in 98. And it was much cleaner and much more together in 98. Transfield, I think it was 98 that you brought it back from the dead, didn't you, and put lifts and everything else in it and made it a real venue, if my history is correct, and it's not later. A little blurry on that. And then in 98, we also went offshore for the first time. So we started to creep into the harbor with Goat Island and Jonathan Watkins Biennale. And then a natural step from Goat Island was Cockatoo Island, which we first explored in 2006, but didn't actually make it onto the island till 2008. The island wasn't ready for us.
And Mike, this is your piece from 1986.
Yes, I did this black box in the corner of the... It was a site-specific piece.
Yeah.
And I couldn't have done this anywhere else. And it had a lowered doorway that faced away, so people had to discover how to get in, and when they got there, they had to turn into dwarfs, you know, and they went in. And Bill Cito again and I, you know, I mean... It's amazing what you do for Biennale. It's a wonder I'm still alive. Anyway, we charred the whole interior of this box for a week or something, and all the MDF was impregnated with formaldehyde. So we would reel out of this blasted box at the end of the day. You know, we were trying to wear respirators, but it was hopeless, you know, because we were just in dense smoke constantly charring the inside. But the result was that when people went in finally, it was extraordinary. It was completely black, but they could just smell this distant, well, it felt distant, but this pervasive burnt timber smell.
Mm.
So there was a smell of fire, and then because of the cracks in the pier and the darkness... you could see all this green water lapping below the pier. So yeah. You just got this very simple experience of the extreme. So the pier enabled that piece,
right.
You see.
Yeah.
And there was a lovely piece near me, Wolfgang Leib's piece was wonderful. This pollen, you know, was fantastic.
Well,
it was a perfect riposte, in a way, to my morbidity.
And it was a white cube, and that was really interesting. You had a black box, and it was a white cube.
Yeah, that's right.
And I remember Anne Flanagan, who used to really have to pay very particular attention to the pollen, because at night creatures would come out,
yes,
and they would run all over. And what they loved running across, Anne, was the pollen. Now that pollen had to be absolutely perfect, and it had to be sifted in such a way that the edge—you could never see an edge. It had to virtually slowly disappear.
Mm.
And to get that, you couldn't kind of fix the footprints up. You know, you had to kind of redo it. And it was constant.
It's such a sensitive piece. I showed the pollen in 2012 in Gwangju Biennale. And then also it takes him so long, like a whole season or like a couple of years, to collect one jar of the pollen. So Volkan was like, you have to make sure that you return everything to me in the jar, because it's important material.
Yeah. The big German sculptors who were in that Biennale with Wolfgang used to tease him and say that this is how he made his sculpture. Just sort of getting the pollen to flick off.
Yes, and then... And then, this is something that John also tell us the story with the painting and the performance.
Well, really, being part of the Biennale encouraged lots of Aboriginal artists and certainly encouraged me to think outside the box and not think about, well, I was dealing in paintings and buying and selling paintings, but with this community. But George Milperu, who was in the original group in 79, he came back and did this performance about the swamp and about magpie geese with a large group of people. Somehow we got the money to bring about 15 people as a performance group to come down and perform a ritual. But we weren't allowed to actually have a fire ritual. Nowadays, everyone has a smoking ceremony to start things, to open buildings, to open events, But in that day, we weren't allowed to light a fire. So everything's cleansed with fire and water. So we actually then presented the second part of it, which was a cleansing with water. It was a really grueling time to look after that number of people. That's all I remember was the thing of looking after that number of people was a real trying thing. Mm-hmm. And I think by the time I got back to Darwin, I think I went to have a sleep. And when I woke up, I thought, I've been asleep for about an hour. But it was actually about 2 days later. it was to introduce this element of performance rather than something that's not physical, something that's not something that has to be experienced rather than things that are left bit not rather than solid objects. Mm. And that was the idea. Mm. Yeah.
And then we go to next version, 1988. I found it very interesting to see Australian Biennale 1988.
That's because it was part of the Bicentennial National Arts Program. Mm. And it was the only Biennale that actually went to another city. And we took it to the National Gallery of Victoria in Melbourne.
Right. That's right.
And so the Bicentennial Authority funded that, and it became the national event, the Australian Biennale for that year. It was also the year that we had a very special project with Japan. We had Close Up Japan that year. And that involved Imai, who did a phenomenal installation here at the gallery with tree trunks and gold leaf and leaves and reeds and nature, a celebration of nature, which was then surrounded by his paintings. And, of course, he wanted them outside. And, you know, these were really delicate paintings. And again, the gallery's conservators came down and said, you know, put their hands to the head and said, "You're not going to let him hang these paintings," you know, because they were full of condensation inside the Perspex screens, vitrines. And that was a phenomenal show. And there were a number of events then also at the Opera House. The Suzuki Company of Toga was there. We had a Butoh dancer. And then we had Hayashi at the Opera House, the drummer. And so that was Close Up Japan, Mitsui sponsored a special section for the Bicentennial Biennale.
I need Mitsui to come back to sponsor the next one, too. But I also thought it's interesting to see this view of world circa 1940 to 88. So it has a sort of longer spectrum of how to look at the art in the context of the Biennale. But also there is an important... the piece of Aboriginal Memorial Project, and John could talk about it. But we have shall we look at the video?
You can do that, yes. We can show you a little bit of video. This video was when we came here, I'd actually, because this had a long lead up time, at least a year to put this work together. I'd got employed Johnny Lewis to come and visit. He was always trying to do something for us or be friends with the Aborigines. So we invited him to come up. We paid him to come up and document the event or the making of things. And then when we got down here and we came to install the work in the pier, he came along and he said, "Well, there's this other friend of mine from the Yellow House, Michael Glasheen, who's a filmmaker, and he could, if you gave us a bit more money, we could actually film the opening of the event." So he came and he filmed the event, and then he said, "Well, for another bit of money, we could actually film the installation. Like, you could take this back home." So, and that kept getting bigger and bigger, till we outlaid about 30,000. But this became an artwork in itself, because Mick Lachine, if you know Mick Lachine, he's a very famous time-lapse photographer or filmmaker. And so he kept coming up with new ideas. And he, so in the end, I end up staying here for practically the whole time to try to finish this film of the poles, which is really amazing. in the end, but and the end of that story is that in the end we never quite got to finish the film. So here we are, whatever it is, 30 years later, the film's not finished. We did get it out of Mick's hands, the negatives, so we could actually make a very high quality digital copy of it. But now we're now trying to source money to actually finish the film. The thing about the actual poles, though, was how it came into being. I was fiddling around and thinking about this installation, and it's really my idea to put this trees, the forest, together. And in 1988, of course, a lot of Aboriginal people and a lot of non-Aboriginal people just thought the whole of the bicentenary was a bit of a wank, and they were boycotting it for lots of reasons. Whether we celebrate the British coming here, etc. And Bernice Murthfield heard about this idea that I had of this forest, and she put me into touch with Nick Waterlow. We had this really weird lunch that was a non-alcoholic lunch for the art world. It was really, at that time, it was really weird, and we had these cups of Earl Grey tea and very fresh food. I think it was salads or whatever. And I just found it really weird at the time. Talked to him about this as seeing the forest of Australia. The Aboriginal Memorial of Australia was the forest of Australia, that every tree had a spirit in it, and they were the memorials of the continent. And he then decided, yes, we'll give this a punt, but we had to raise quite a bit of money to actually make it work and make it happen. And it's a sign of the times of one of the leftovers of the Whitlam period was you had people like James Mollison who would make decisions, and he would make decisions quickly. He would bear those things responsibly. That's my responsibility. Okay, I'll wear this. And he just said, we'll commission the whole piece. And he said, practically said, look, we can give you a check for half of the money now before I left the building. So people could do things in those days. Doesn't happen these days. They decide to chop trees down very quickly.
It's our contribution.
Yeah, that's
ring bargain.
Ring bargain, that's right.
Yeah.
But so it came together over 2 years, and what you don't know is the place where these were made is one of the remote places in Australia. It's hundreds of miles from anywhere. There was about one plane a week. There's a barge once a month. So I almost personally packed nearly every one of these poles and loaded them onto trucks, loaded them onto planes, loaded them onto barges to get the work here. So that's...
John, we have we have some beautiful black and white photos of that, 8x10s of you on with the truck and packing the poles.
Yes.
They're in the archive.
Well, I was a bit younger then. But it was the only way. I just thought if everyone boycotted the Biennale, not only the Biennale, but the Bicentenary, I thought absence is not going to make any political statement. Mm. Absence is not going to make the world aware of us. And that's why I decided to, we'd have this inclusion, but it'd be this is what the British coming here meant to us. Besides bad food, but this death and the destruction of our society, I'd say loosely. So I'd almost forgotten about it. The other day I gave a talk in Lismore, where Mike grew up, about this, and somebody asked me about this, and I thought it's so long ago. I'd almost forgotten about it in one way. but part of the thing you were talking about, the Joseph Boyce piece and a number of other pieces, the Japanese art of sculpture, that I think that every festival or whatever you, or celebration of art, you have to have something that stays behind and has to be left here. And Mollison commissioned this and agreed that the work would be permanently on display in the National Gallery. So it's that kind of thing that you've got to drive, that things have to remain, because these experiences here, we're all like a grey ghost group here. And I think we remember things, but the beautiful experiences, etc. But these things have got to remain as some sort of marker or memory or mnemonic device to think about why we did them. Yeah.
Thank you. It's a beautiful story. Can we go back to the slide, please? Yeah, this is some of the drawings and... this is beautiful. This is such a beautiful drawing.
It is.
This is how it was installed.
Yes. Well, I used to get all those little red dots you'd put into galleries. I got all these little packets of red dots and green dots and whatever. And I had a school textbook, you know, I had a school book of graph paper and sort of drew that in. I do everything with the least degree of difficulty or simply. So it was just to get. You know, I'm a sort of a bush carpenter, so I just draw me a picture and we'll say yes. And that's me hiding there. Yes.
And John, tell the story about the sand.
Go on, tell me more. Drop me some more. We put the sand, yeah, we put sand in. Yes, it was hard to get the colour, etc. Luca's father actually designed the stands for these. Franco designed the stands for us, so we were able to put them in. I had a team of young artists to help me to put these, the poles in. We had trouble finding the right colour sand. We also, there was a performance, and that's why I say we had a little bit of money, and I kept doling this out to Mick Lachine to go and buy some more film. We just about wore out our welcome with Johnny Lewis. We were staying at his place anyway, but then he sort of got a bit tired of that after a while. He thinks this is one of his great achievements, or he was able to contribute to. It did everything, I must say, it did everything that historically Aboriginal art is about, people collaborating together and group performance. You come together and make things, but you perform together and collaborate, and that's how I now believe, that's how I try to do all my projects now.
And Mike, you came back Art Gallery in New South Wales in the same year, 88.
88?
Yes.
Is this 88?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No, that's 2000.
Oh.
No, that's 2000.
Oh, maybe we are wrong.
Yeah, we moved on.
That's 2000.
Can you tell us about this performance?
Yes. It's this white bride. This is very good tension for John, actually.
Yes.
So it was a complete wax illusion. And I told the story while we were sitting downstairs in the cafe. Daniel Mocquet, a Frenchman who was here in Australia for a while, had been in to see that. And he went down to the cafe and I was sitting there drinking a coffee, and he got a terrible fright. He said, "I've just been upstairs, you were there and now you're here." So it had that sort of ambiguity, and it was intended to be that way, because I'd done a number of performances before this piece. I'd done one in the art gallery where I was asleep for 3 days, lying on the floor. And I was so still, when I wasn't asleep, I was completely still, so people didn't know whether I was a simulation or a reality. So, yes, this was the piece. But there was much more in this room as well. That's a
complex room installation that I did for this Biennale.
Yeah, I realize that we are already running out of our time. Yeah. But I just flipped through the rest of the slides. And every day, 98 by Jonathan Watkins. And this is actually my... I didn't see the show, but a lot of my friends started to participate in this version. So it's kind of a new era of... A lot of Asian artists also participated in this every day. And this was first appearance of Olafur Eliasson. And then also Nawin Dawan Chaikul, Thai artist, and then another artist, Surasi Kusorwon. And these are kind of starting to show new generation of the artists from the region. And they are still very important artists. Then this is 2000. And this was a time when they composed a selection committee instead of asking for one artistic director.
And Nick chaired that, And Fumio Nanjo was involved, and Nick Sirota, and Harold Zeman, Hedy, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Then, this is Xama 2000.
Yes.
Then, On Reason and Emotion is 2004. Yeah, this, we can still see this piece on Hickson Road.
Yeah, Jimmy Dunn.
And this is by Charles Medeveta, 2006.
2006,
This is also at the PR 2002.
Yeah, this is Gormley, isn't it?
Yeah. This is Anthony Gormley's amazing piece on the PR 23.
Yeah, Asian Field. And it also had all the documentary photographs of the making of the piece, which was also fascinating.
Yeah.
But when this came in, it was unbelievable because there were so many plastic crates with these figures in. It was absolutely unbelievable. And it's the first time that we used the upper story of Pier 23. So if you went up there, it was just a sea of crates all stacked up in columns. It seemed impossible that you would ever be able to unpack them all and set them up. And that was really a tour de force. I can't remember how many hundreds of volunteers were involved, but it was enormous.
Yeah, but it was really a major piece. I remember seeing this installation.
Yeah, I did too. Very much remember that installation.
It's amazing.
And Charles also did homage of the Aboriginal Memorial again in 2006.
We had a lot of trouble with the bark paintings at the end of the pier because we had some very, very humid and wet weather. And one morning there was actually fog inside the pier and the barks were warping, frightening.
John, were you part of this?
Well, this is from Terry Murrawilly, Jumbawa, and who's... still a good friend of mine, and that what was an interesting thing with him was, though, at the APT, right away from the Biennale, there was an Indian artist from Orissa in India, and he gave a talk about how his uncles and fathers had seen this Aboriginal man at an exhibition in New Delhi, and how they were very incredibly inspired by seeing this black man there being a great international artist and being a success, and that inspired them then to paint more and take up their artistic careers more. And anyway, someone, Jeremy Eccles or someone, was telling me this story and saying, I've just heard this really great story and it's really fantastic. And I said, yeah. And then I was thinking about it and I thought, yeah, I curated that exhibition that took Terry Murrawilly to India to exhibit in New Delhi, which was really funny. Anyway, I'd forgotten all about it again. It's Alzheimer's or something. I'd forgotten about it. But in this case, after the Aboriginal Memorial had been installed at in the National Gallery, where it still is today, and you'll see it in a new installation near the doorway, the entrance to the gallery. All the people in Eastern Arnhem Land, where this tradition exists, then started to think about how this was a sculptural object and how this could be then played with and decorated. People did lots of things to innovations and variations on this as, and especially in Yirrkala, which is way over to the east from us. It's about 300 miles from where we live, or in Ramengitting. And so I didn't have much to do with this because that's really at Yirrkala. But yeah, that's like a homage to the Aboriginal Memorial. Yeah.
And 2008, when Mike, I had, you almost had a sort of mini retrospective.
Yes, I did indeed. And that was amazing, really, Carolyn Christoph Bakargiev. Mm-hmm. She came to my studio and she said, I want to see some of your performance videos. I thought, well, this will be very simple. It'll either be over in 10 minutes and she'll walk down the steps or she'll stay for a while. So I put on my most difficult videos from the early 70s, and she said, I want to show all this work. But it was very interesting because, like all biennales, it was immensely complex. She also wanted me to do this piece on Pier 2-3, and I spent an enormous amount of time and energy designing this enormous labyrinth. It was, you know, I've done a number of these things. The idea was that you'd be inside this and there'd be this sort of, it'd operate by rumour. So people would go in over the 3 months of the Biennale or something, get lost in this labyrinth. It would take them 4 hours to arrive somewhere. But where they arrive would be extraordinarily ambiguous, and then they'd go out and they'd tell everyone, and everyone would do the same thing, go in and find, but there'd be nothing there because I'd close that room off secretly on an intermittent basis. So I was going to create massive disturbances, you see. But the OH&S became insuperable because someone said, well, you know, how, you know, people might become claustrophobic. Yes, yes, anything. All of this is possible. But someone might leave a bomb in there. And I thought, as soon as I heard that, I'm finished. There's no way we're going to do this installation. There's no answer to that kind of paranoia. So what I'm really saying is that created a tremendous distraction. By the time we focused on Cockatoo Island, Carolyn was incredibly stressed out. She showed me some buildings. I said, I'll have that building. And this is the other side of the Biennale. This cost me about 50 grand, John. So I had to raise the money because the Biennale never has any money. And I was determined to do this piece. So I went out and rewired the building, got it all organised, and the roof was leaking, the water was pouring in, all this electrics, you know what I mean? Again, the OH&S, it was right on a razor's edge. But in the end, I did 17 rooms of installations in this terrible building. And I think I divided the Australian art world with that. It was called Mirror Arse. And it was absolutely uncompromising. So it was my opportunity, really. I mean, it was fantastic for me. I was able to do the site-specific work that I'd wanted to do for sort of 30 years, really.
Fantastic.
And it happened at the Biennale.
Fantastic.
It happened at the Biennale.
Yeah.
So the Biennale, this is the thing about the Biennale. It must.
You're absolutely right.
John's been talking about this.
That's exactly.
You know, it must enable. Gormley, we all remember this installation. Exactly. It's got to be.
And often these opportunities, or whatever you want to call them, occur quite late in the piece with things changing, and you have to be adaptable, and you have to take an opportunity and seize it and run with it. And you talked about the razor's edge, and you're absolutely right. Yeah. It is the razor's edge.
But the Biennale brought that energy out. I thought, it's do or die, you know what I mean? And so it happened.
Yeah.
And it changed everything, in a way, for me anyway. So I think that's the point of the Biennale, you know, that it's got to be dynamic, and you know, we talk our individual stories, but it's got a cultural implication, which you represent very well, Djon. And this is what the Biennale's done. I mean, it really has kind of crashed through and introduced new art into Australia.
And it's groomed audiences that. It's one thing to bring a product somewhere. It's another thing to fertilize the ground.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think when you look at all the educational programs, the public programs, the you know the publications, the DVDs, all the things that have been produced, and now more recently much more accessible on the internet, it's decades of hard slog to get an educated audience, an appreciative audience together. You look at those 1,000 to 1,200 schools that used to get a free education kit from the Biennale every 2 years, thanks again to the Art Gallery of New South Wales Education Department. That would be distributed free, and then we would produce all these educational programs for teachers and students. Mm. That, over two decades, creates a whole generation of people that are ready. Ready for art.
Mm.
And it's built this audience, you know, because the audience goes on increasing with every Biennale. It's sort of...
Well, certainly with Aboriginal art, it's opened up people's eyes to think of Aboriginal art as not this, not that, or whatever. And also Aboriginal artists, of course, are saying, well, we don't have to make number 63 sort of thing. And people, I remember 88, well, I met, really got engaged with Roslyn's gallery, and we did a number of exhibitions, and then they, she took Tracy Moffat into that that stable, and Fiona Foley, and she now has Daniel Boyd and other people, and that sort of opens up that for artists, like you were saying. Then I think every artist, you end up going backwards financially somehow, but in order to keep the money going around. You need that as well.
Yes, it's interesting. Yeah. It's not a problem of money, really. I mean, money's always a problem. But if it's significant, if the opportunity is there to sort of break through in some way, then everyone's going to pull together, you know. So when I mention money, I mean, I have to mention money, you know what I mean? Because it's always a big aspect of the Biennale. There's never enough money. Mm. And everyone's trying to do these projects and... it's got to be remembered, because that's really part of the contribution.
Mm.
You know, the Biennale could just become formalized as a sort of bureaucracy, and it could be a bureaucratic story finally. But it's very important to keep, I think, turning that over, recreating the upheaval that accompanies every Biennale, because the upheaval is fertile. And it's where the future is, you know. I think that's really important. But anyway, that's how I see it.
Thank you very much.
That was a beautiful statement.
I think it's a fantastic ending lines.
Yes, yes.
And it's such a pity that we're already quarter hour over. But I really would like to continue this series and inviting different voices. And maybe some of you might be on the stage next time. But I think for me, it's such an important learning process and putting so much pressure on me. But it's much more than that. And I just wanted to carry these important stories to the next 20, 40 years. And thank you very much, Djon, Paula, and Mike, for sharing your memories.